Which leads us to our very next speaker, Mr. Ruud Gal. He's site manager of DSM, a large pharmaceutical company. And he's going to give his perspective on brighter life, brighter science. There you are. Ruud, I'll give the floor to you. Which microphone? The microphone that you are holding is actually for the film registration that we're running. And do you want a microphone like this, or do you want to use that one? There you are. The floor is yours.
Good afternoon.
Good evening.
I will just like to start. Would like to start with a small movie. It's only 80 seconds, so you probably will survive even in the YouTube times.
At DSM, we care about the people living on this planet. Sustainability drives everything we do. We create solutions for brighter living. Our brand says it all. Bright science, brighter living. It's who we are. It's what we stand for. And what we aim to achieve. A promise to the world in which we operate. Our brand is all around us, uniting us, defining us. We engage, connect, as one voice, one face, one DSM. Creating brighter lives for people today and generations to come.
Five, right? Okay, thank you, Jasper, for your kind invitation. Thank you, Katinka, for your very eloquent talk. You put me on a big challenge here. My name is Ruud Gal. I'm Dutch. Married to Mar, who's Spanish, Gallega. We live with our three children just on the other side of Tibidabo in San Cugat del Vallès. And I work for DSM. DSM has been my first professional love, and we're still together. It's been about almost 20 years. And I started in the Netherlands as an engineer in a fiber intermediates plant. And from there, we've moved to Spain, from Spain to the Netherlands, from the Netherlands to France, and now we're very happy to be back here in Barcelona. And since 2013, since last year, I have the pleasure and the honor to act as a site manager for two production locations for DSM resins. And we make resins, which are basically the base compound for paint, yeah, paint and inks. So we make powder coating resins, we make waterborne resins, etc. And I'm happy to show you a bit more, give you a bit more insight how we define, live, sustainability within DSM. And I hope to make a little bit of a bridge between the corporate pep talk and the local implementation of all that strategy and guidelines. It all starts with a message. You can say, okay, this is the message of our CEO. And you can say, well, this is the message basically is we can only be successful in a society that doesn't fail. If not, we will not be sustainable. It's a nice message from yet another CEO, but I hope I can show you and convince you that this is something really like a core value in the company and that we live also from day to day on all layers in the organization. So we translate that in our mission statement, which is basically that we want to make life a little bit better for people every day. Yeah, as simple as that. And we do that with a sustainable approach. I'd like to show you that in DSM, the way we act is really sustainability. Say one, it is a core value of the company, and it's also the only and the key driver for innovation. Yeah, so I have a few examples that I would like to show you, and then after that, maybe we can have a little interaction to work a bit more on it. So just a little bit about DSM. We are all over the globe. Nobody knows us except the Dutch people. We're a Dutch company, we try to be a very global company, and for the moment that we're pretty successful because we're all over the globe with about 25,000 employees, and we're growing a lot in the high growth economies. Yeah, so that's the international strategy. And we are a life science and material science group. That means that, for example, if you tomorrow morning you take a vitamin C pill, there's about 65% chance that the ingredients come from DSM. We don't sell it, that's why nobody knows us, but we make the base ingredient and we are a business-to-business company, mainly. But we also are material science. So we make polymers. If you have your iPhone, for example, there's plastics inside your iPhone that come from DSM. Yeah, so Apple is a good customer of us. We sell for about 10 billion euros per year, with an EBITDA of about 1.3 billion. So yes, we want to make profit. Yeah, we want to be profitable. That's not a secret. Yeah. However, to become profitable and to be profitable on the long run, we want to be a sustainable company. That's the philosophy. So for global presence, we're on the stock market, which is one of the challenges we have. I think I talked about challenges, and it's not always easy. And we see, in general, you see that on the stock market, investors more and more are looking for short-term benefits. And although they believe that sustainability is a good value and a good principle, tomorrow morning I want to make money. Yeah? And that's not always easy for a company to cope with. For the moment it works, because the last 25 years that's a pretty difficult word, quintupled our share price. That means that it's one of the most sustainable stocks on the European stock market. We are basically in life science, in material science, in a lot of different sectors. We go from enzymes to yeast. We are in beer and wine. We are in pharmaceuticals, engineering plastics, automotive, in electronics, you name it, construction. And what we really like is that we want to... I thought it was on the next one. Where we think one of our opportunities is in the future is, and currently is in the mix of life science and material science. So we apply, for example, the technology and the know-how we've got from the bakery ingredients, the yeast production. With yeast production, we also made pharmaceuticals. And now we translate that to make, for example, second generation biofuels. We do that with POET, you saw that in the movie. So instead of making biofuel, bioethanol from corn, which is competing with the food market, which we make now bioethanol with the wheat, yeah, basically, with an enzymatic process. On the other end, for example, from the material cluster, we take, for example, Dyneema, one of the fibers we make, the world's strongest fiber, we call it. We use that now in surgery, in knee surgery, for example. Completely different. So we take material science to life science. And that's the X factor, we call it, where we try to make the best of both worlds. So as I say, sustainability is really at the core of the strategy of DSM. And we do that in two standard life cycle approach, but the novelty, or maybe not so much, but what we do is not only an environmental life cycle analysis, but also a people life cycle analysis. We call it Eco Plus and People Plus. So we want to make, develop, and manufacture and sell products that have a better impact on the environment, so give a higher value with less impact on the environment. At the same time, we want to make products and develop products that have a better impact on people than competing alternatives. Eco products, I hope to give some examples now. It means any product that has a better value with less impact on the environment. Yeah. That's measurable. Eh? It's not something that we have to audit it and everything. That's not, we call it Eco Plus and that's it. We have to do a lot of measurements and a lot of auditing to certify that. And we see that it's really growing. Yeah, it's a market value. The market is more and more demanding for Eco Plus products. I'm in the paint industry, and sometimes even the market is going faster than we can innovate. Yeah? In France, for example, there's a lot of demand for really label-free painting, and that's a big challenge for us. So we try to develop and create new paints or resins, which is the basis for a paint that is completely label-free. I think I have a nice example. People Plus, as I say, we try to make products that are Eco Plus, good value with less impact on the environment, and at the same time products that are help people to have a better life. For example, the operation with the Dyneema fiber, and I have some more examples. And a lot of times they go together. A nice example is resins. And resins is paint. And I think we all know or remember that paint used to smell an awful lot because paint was made with solvents. About 50% was solvent, yeah? Xylene or whatever. Enzymatic processes are part of the beer processing, yeah? You need enzymes to make beer. And DSM has engineered an enzymatic solution that basically causes to a need for less energy to make the same liter of beer. Now, and another nice example is of DSM is that we do a lot of work on products, on Eco and People Plus. And at the same time, if we talk people, planet, and profit, we talked about the profit, we talked about the planet, we talked about people. But it's not only the customer, it's also our neighbors, it's our own employees, and it's a society. Yeah. And one of the nicest things for me as a person working in this company is the collaboration of DSM with the United Nations World Food Program. It basically comes down to the fact that we want to fight hunger together with the United Nations. And as we say, we really believe that taking care of the society is not only an NGO job, it's also the companies that have to work there. I call this, when I try to hire somebody for DSM, I use this as an example. Our CEO was named a humanitarian person of the year by the United Nations in 2010, I believe. Yeah, and his predecessor was Kofi Annan. So, speaking about making things hard fact, yeah, that's something that's really measurable, I would say. And so what we do, we try to fight the nutrition challenge in the world. And the nutrition challenge is of course, an undernutrition, but it's more a malnutrition. So it's not a matter of how much food there is, it's also the quality of the food. So bluntly speaking, bringing in bags of rice is good and helpful, but the challenge is really in the micronutrients, in the micro ingredients of that food, the quality of the food. What DSM has developed together with the United Nations is, for example, micro envelopes with small envelopes with a mix of vitamins, minerals, enzymes that can be mixed with the rice, for example, and very easily distributed to make a big change in the quality of the food. And that has a big impact on the growth development of children, for example. Yeah. So we basically, it's a real partnership, and DSM provides scientific knowledge, we support money, but more interestingly, we also give human resources. It's a very common for employees of DSM to participate in a mission for about 2-3 months or some weeks in Kenya and Bangladesh. And they really, so we pick out people who are good in logistics to help on the logistics part, and we send them over. And I had some people of my organization joining this kind of projects. And if they come back, the boost for them is really is amazing. Yeah, so they learn a lot, they help a lot, but their motivation it's amazing how they come back. This is a really nice example of how we implement corporate social responsibility in a very interesting way, I think. Another local initiative, which I would like to explain, is that how do we translate this in a day-to-day company? I'm a site manager, so I can go to my people and say, you have to spend less energy, etc. What happens in my organization is that we have a group of people, they created their own company within the company. So they saw this sustainability pep talk and said, look, we can do better and we want to do something ourselves. So they created the eco company within my organization. And it's a group of about 12 people, I believe. And there's no managers allowed. So not even allowed in the meetings. There's no engineers, there's no manager, there's no human resources, no nobody. It's the shift manager, it's the operator, it's the mechanic. And they created their own company with their own goals, their own planning, their own projects. And they demand resources. And they demand time, they present themselves when we have a visitor. And it's so super successful that, for example, in the Villafranca plant we have here for powder coating, we have produced, this year we have produced 10% more with 10% less energy uses per ton. So, we are the objective I have for 5 years, for 2020, I have to reduce with 20%. In 1 year we've done it. And the good thing is, I didn't even I wasn't even involved. Yeah. So yeah, that's the nice thing I want to show how this translates. If it's not just a pep talk, but really a value in a company, you keep this on for a long, long time. Automatically, things pop up, and people get really motivated. Because if the CEO comes over, then they present their work, and I just basically lean back and I'm proud. Yeah. And that's very nice. So that's basically what I wanted to explain about DSM. I have some more examples of products. Maybe if you like to see that, or maybe there's questions you would like to ask, or challenges, criticism, whatever you like.
Here you are.
Thank you for your talk. I would like to ask you, what are the arguments that you use for your clients whenever you want to sell a product? We know that sustainable products might be more expensive, it might take more time to be built, or whatever is the output. What are the arguments that you use for your clients to sell your product against something else that might be cheaper, for example, but yours is better?
Sometimes it's a struggle, and we have to add other things like technical servers, joint application, joint innovation together to make them. So we really want to position ourselves as a partner towards customers and not just a paint producer. And we also, for that reason, we have stepped out of the base market. So we don't produce any more wall paints, for example. Yeah. So the standard products are not part of our portfolio anymore. We really go to the high-end part of the product portfolio, where there's a lot of technological challenges, and customers really need a high-tech company. And then this discussion is much more easy. Yeah. So that's the way we try to deal with it. But it's not always easy. It's a fight for the... Yeah, we want to be on the high end of the market, and sometimes we're more expensive. So, but we also see that, as we believe that by being more sustainable, we have a better future, we also see that the customers who are front runners are usually better customers on the long run. So it's a win-win there.
I have another question too. For this wonderful thing that you've been doing in the ECHO program, how do you motivate your workers to want to do that? What do you do to motivate them?
Okay, one of the things I told you, if you want to take care of planet, profit, and people, yeah. If you take care of people, we take care of our customers, we take care of our neighbors, we also take care of our own employees. So every year there is a employee engagement survey. It's mandatory, and it's also my target. So if my engagement survey is good, I get extra points. Yeah. I did a good job. So I'm really, every manager in the company is valued. One of his targets is employee engagement. Basically the manager do a good job if the people are happy. Of course, we believe that if a person is happy, it's not a free ride. I mean, we know that people are working, are happy in their work, they're more productive, and they stay longer in the company. So it's a win-win situation. So we do engagement surveys, and one of the outcomes of the engagement survey was that 86% of the people believe that we do a good job with respect to sustainability. And this was one of our lowest scores in the engagement survey. The lowest score was salary. That's always the last one, but we say, how do you think we are safe at work? And the score is 95%. Is there any bullying? Do you have training? And then the score is 90%. And sustainability was one of the lowest. So we asked people, do you have any ideas to do this better? We asked that 2 years ago, and then this initiative came up, and they would say, yeah, please go. So we just did the engagement this year. I don't have the results yet, but I hope somewhere end of December, early January, I hope this score went up. Mm.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Any more questions for Rutgal? There you are. It's Laudy.
You talked, Ruud, about this, I saw one moment, the environmental declaration of the products.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, you are, for the paint industry, is it a worldwide organization setting these standards? How does it work very much? I mean, you always have to compare your product to the product of other people. So who defines by which criteria you are going to be valued?
Okay. The labeling, basically you speak about labeling of products, and there's a very strong regulation in the European Union. So the REACH regulation is the toughest, I would say, in the world at this moment. So we try to copy the same formulas all over the world. to prevent a lot of complexity in the company, basically. But yeah, I can say that the European, the REACH regulation is the most demanding regulation there is in the world on that. So yeah, that's also sometimes a bit of an issue because, yeah, you, as a European company, you're challenged with respect to pricing towards export, especially towards Asia. Yeah, because the REACH regulation is not yet in place. So that's sometimes a bit of a struggle. But we compensate that by having raw material sourcing and also production locally, both in Asia as well as in the United States.
But this European Union regulations, I mean, you have to comply.
Of course. Yeah.
They're
there's compulsory. No debate. Yeah.
There's nothing beyond, in your industry, beyond the compulsory?
Yeah, of course. Yeah, that's the big challenge. This is exactly the challenge. We see that this trend is coming. Yeah. So we try to be front runners. That's the main thing. So we try to make the top paint, which is complying and has better performance than competing alternatives. That's the technology. That's the technology challenge I was talking about. Yeah. And it's also sometimes also a selling challenge.
Another famous multinational called Ericsson is gained a lot of points when they tried to push down the whole production chain, all of their suppliers, in towards sustainability goals and CSR goals. Is that something that you also do? So talk with suppliers in order to green or to improve their sub-products that you buy from them? Is it a criterion in the purchasing process?
It is. And also, yeah, so first of all, we try to source as local as possible, if possible. And at the same time, we do supplier evaluation, supplier audits. We go to suppliers, to their factories, to see if they produce in a sustainable way. Yeah. So that's absolutely part of our obligations, yeah. But further than that, I must say also say that we see also the trend with our suppliers. We also get audits from our suppliers to see if we deal their product correctly on our side. So it's both ways, actually. So it's getting better, by the way, by the day, yeah.
So there we are. I'd like to ask for a big hand for Ruud Gal. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.